Quantitative research is driven by research questions and hypotheses. For every hypothesis, there is an unstated null hypothesis. The null hypothesis does not need to be explicitly stated because it is always the opposite of the hypothesis. In order to demonstrate that a hypothesis is likely true, researchers need to compare it to the opposite situation. The research hypothesis will be about some kind of relationship between variables. The null hypothesis is the assertion that the variables being tested are not related and the results are the product of random chance events. Remember that null is kind of like no, so a null hypothesis means there is no relationship. For example, if a researcher asks the question, "Does having class for 12 hours in one day lead to nursing student burnout?" the hypothesis would indicate the researcher's best guess of the results. A 12-hour day of classes causes nursing students to burn out. Therefore, the null hypothesis would be that 12 hours of class in one day has nothing to do with student burnout. The only way of backing up a hypothesis is to refute the null hypothesis. Instead of trying to prove the hypothesis that 12 hours of class causes burnout, the researcher must show that the null hypothesis is likely wrong. This rule means assuming that there is not a relationship until there is evidence to the contrary. In every study, there is a chance for error. There are two major types of error in quantitative research, type 1 and type 2. Logically, since they are defined as errors, both types of error focus on mistakes the researcher may make. Sometimes talking about type 1 and type 2 errors can be mentally tricky because it seems like you're talking in double and even triple negatives. It is because both type 1 and 2 errors are defined according to the researcher's decision regarding the null hypothesis, which assumes no relationship among variables. Instead of remembering the entire definition of each type of error, just remember which type has to do with rejecting and which one is about accepting the null hypothesis. A type 1 error occurs when the researcher mistakenly rejects the null hypothesis. If the null hypothesis is rejected, it means that the researcher has found a relationship among variables. So a type 1 error happens when there is no relationship, but the researcher finds one. A type 2 error is the opposite. A type 2 error occurs when the researcher mistakenly accepts the null hypothesis. If the null hypothesis is accepted, it means that the researcher has not found a relationship among variables. So a type 2 error happens when there is a relationship, but the researcher does not find it. To remember the difference between these errors, think about a stubborn person. Remember that your first instinct as a researcher may be to reject the null hypothesis, because you want your prediction of an existing relationship to be correct. If you decide that your hypothesis is right when you are actually wrong, a type 1 error has occurred. A type 2 error happens when you decide your prediction is wrong when you are actually right. It is much harder to convince a stubborn person that they are wrong. Therefore, it is the number 2 possibility. One way to help you remember the meaning of a type 1 and type 2 error is to find an example or analogy that helps you remember. As a nurse, you may identify most with the idea of thinking about medical tests. A lot of teachers use the analogy of a courtroom when explaining type 1 and 2 errors. I thought students may appreciate our example study regarding class schedules. It is impossible to know for sure when an error occurs. But researchers can control the likelihood of making an error in statistical decision-making. The likelihood of making an error is related to statistical considerations that are used to determine the needed sample size for a study. When determining a sample size, researchers need to consider the desired power, expected effect size, and the acceptable significance level. Power is the probability that the researcher will make a correct decision to reject the null hypothesis when it is in reality false, therefore avoiding a type 2 error. It refers to the probability that your test will find a statistically significant difference when such a difference actually exists. Another way to think about it is the ability of a test to detect an effect if the effect really exists. The more power a study has, the lower the risk of a type 2 error is. If power is low, the risk of a type 2 error is high. Logically, Power increases as the sample size increases, since you've collected more information, which makes it easier to correctly reject a null hypothesis. Other factors, including the effect size and significance level, also influence power. Usually, power is set at 0.8 or greater before a study begins, meaning that you should have an 80% or greater chance of finding a statistically significant difference when there is one. This value is used to calculate the needed sample size for a study before it begins. A statistically significant result does not mean that there is an important or meaningful difference in the influence of one variable on another variable. It simply indicates that the researcher can be confident a difference exists. Particularly with large sample sizes, even very small differences can be statistically significant. To determine how meaningful or important the difference is, the effect size needs to be calculated. Effect sizes are a standardized measure of how large the influence of one variable is on another variable. Another way to look at it is the degree to which the null hypothesis is false. Before a study begins, an effect size, either known or estimated, is used as a part of the power analysis in order to determine how large of a sample is needed to achieve a power of greater than or equal to 0.8. There are a variety of ways to calculate the effect size, which is measured in standard deviations. When interpreting or critiquing research, the guidelines developed by Cohen are often used. However, keep in mind that these are simply guidelines. Effect sizes need to be interpreted within the context of the research. Statistical significance is used to determine how likely it is that the results of a study are due to chance. Before a study begins, the alpha level is set at a value that represents the error that a researcher is willing to accept. Typically, 0.05 is used, which means that if the null hypothesis is true, it would only be rejected in 5 out of 100 trials. If a smaller risk of rejecting the null hypothesis is needed, an alpha of 0.01 may also be used. You might wonder why we don't always use the lowest possible alpha value. It is because type 1 and type 2 errors are inversely related. If you decrease one, you increase the other. People consider a type 1 error more serious, which is why 0.05 is the minimum conventionally accepted level in most disciplines. Researchers need to accept a certain level of chance that they may be wrong. Before a study begins, a balancing act occurs where researchers decide what values are appropriate for the study. Don't confuse alpha with p. Alpha levels are determined before the study begins. P values are calculated from sample data after the study has been completed. If the p value is less than the alpha value, the null hypothesis is rejected and the results are statistically significant. Just because a study has a statistically significant result does not mean the results will have practical significance. Statistically significant differences can always be found, even for very small differences, if the sample size is large enough. Practical significance relates to how relevant the findings are to the question being asked. For example, a study may find that there is a statistically significant difference in the lifespan of people who take a new drug compared to the old one. The statistically significant difference may be only a few hours and come with very severe side effects. Most people would say that the improvement in lifespan is not practically significant. Make sure you consider if the differences are big enough to have real meaning. It may help to go back and consider the effect size, among other things, to help you answer this question. A power analysis is most often used to calculate what sample size is needed. However, it can be used to calculate sample size, effect size, significance level, or power if you have 3 of the 4 values. Since alpha is usually 0.5 and power is usually 0.8, researchers need to pay the most attention to the effect size in order to calculate the needed sample size. Thank you for watching. If you are looking for more information, you are welcome to check out my ebook, website, and related videos. Links are provided in the description.